This is the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. If you're a hardcore angler, you've come to the right place. This is a weekly podcast that will interview some of the top smallmouth bass anglers in North America. Travis and his guest will discuss what it takes to consistently catch big smallmouth, and you'll get a glimpse inside the mind of a trophy smallmouth angler. And now, here's your host of the Smallmouth Crush Podcast, Travis Manson.
Yo, welcome to the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. My name is Travis Manson. Hope you guys are having a great week. I got a great show coming up for everybody. Jeff Gustafson joins us, otherwise known as Gussie, if you will. That's what he goes by. He won't get mad if you call him Gussie. One of the top smallmouth anglers in the country. He knows what he's doing. In this episode, we get into it as far as throwing one of the best smallmouth baits on the planet. A hair jig, a marabou hair jig. So he's going to break down how he utilizes that technique to put monster smallmouth bass in the boat. But first, let's talk about the sponsors of the show. Of course, we have The Real Shot, located in Northeast Wisconsin, one of the premier tackle stores out there. They support this podcast. And in the show description, there's a link. So if you're looking at purchasing some tackle and you go through that link, it just helps out the show even more. Of course, Monster Bass right behind me, the Better Box. Monthly subscription to the Monster Bass. They actually have a bunch of different boxes out there. Multi-species boxes, ice fishing boxes, and then your regional box. You can use the Travis10 code for your first purchase over at monsterbass.com. So without further ado, let's get him on. All right, well, here he is in studio. Well, at least I am. Where are you at?
I'm up in Canada. I'm at home right now. So, bundled up a little bit.
And, I see that.
Just living the dream here in the wilderness.
Living the Canadian life. So, Jeff, what do you go by? Do you prefer Jeff or Gussie? I mean, I want to call you the right name here.
Yeah, I know. Gussie's kind of worked out for me pretty good. And, I've known you for a long time, fished the Sturgeon Bay Open for many years. And back when you were fishing the Elite Series, you fished the Sturgeon Bay Open a few times. Or,
sure.
I know you were there around that time. So you had a big target on your back. You didn't know who I was, but you were kind of the guy everyone wanted to beat there, I think. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's an amazing fishery. Growing up in that area of Wisconsin, the Sturgeon Bay, Lake Michigan, that whole northern deal and the Great Lakes is something I just kind of fell in love with and can't seem to shake it. So I'm addicted to the smallmouth as you are. Definitely one of the top 50 anglers, if not, as far as smallmouth anglers and largemouth, of course. But when it comes to the smallmouth game, you got it dialed in, man. And I just want to really dig in. The whole purpose of this podcast is to really dig into the minds of these, expert smallmouth anglers that just can go out there and dominate regardless of what body of water that they're fishing and time in again and again, put some big smallmouth in the boat. You're up in Canada. Where's your, I guess, home body of water? What would you consider your home body of water when it comes to smallmouth fishing?
So for me, home body is Lake of the Woods and right on the Minnesota border. So I live about 60 miles north of the border, but for anyone that's not sure where it is, we got Rainy Lake and Lake of the Woods here and pretty much center of the continent. So 7 hours north of Minneapolis and that's home for me. So traveling around, you're still doing it. It's a project if you live up north and even more so for me with the border stuff, especially this year. But if you love doing it, then you figure out a way to do it and make it happen. So
it's Rainy Lake, Lake of the Woods. Is that where you, I didn't want to cut you off. Is that where you grew up and learned how to catch smallmouth?
And that's exactly what I was going to say is sure. It's a phenomenal fishery. It's a big body of water, 1 million acres, 14,000 islands, and, really good fishing. We don't get the giant fish that you see in the Great Lakes. It seems like the zebra mussels and gobies are their recipe for that, but phenomenal fishing, and you can catch fish shallow, deep, kind of of all the places that I've traveled to fish, you know, I would compare it to Champlain, but with more places to hide. You can hide out a little better because of all the islands, but similar to Champlain.
Sure. You mentioned fishing Sturgeon Bay when you were younger. You know, as far as branching out from Lake of the Woods, what was your next like moment of, wow, this is some awesome smallmouth fishing? You know, where would that be?
For me, it was Sturgeon Bay. And that, I think the first time I went was like 2005, maybe 2004, 2005. And, you know, at that time, you could go there for the week and you'd probably catch a 5-pounder, but it wasn't like the giants hadn't like erupted there quite yet.
Sure.
It was, you know, 4 or 5 years after I started going. But yeah, Sturgeon Bay would have been my first experience on the Great Lakes. And then, you know, just from there, I started fishing the FLW Tour in 2012 or 13, and then got to go to Lake St. Clair, Detroit River, Champlain, and you know, sort of expand where I'd been. But Sturgeon Bay, you know, I probably fished there 150 to 200 days in my life. So I've got a lot of time on that place. And that's kind of where I, you know, cut my teeth on the Great Lakes type fishing.
Sure. So since you went on tour, what was some of the things that you could take with you from your experience on Lake of the Woods and apply it to, say, the Great Lakes, but even some, let's talk some smallmouth down south as well. Do you feel like you were really prepared to experience all those different bodies of water? Was it kind of a learn as you go experience? How did that all play out?
It really, for me, was learn as you go. But the one thing that I think sort of has helped me is up here, I mean, we have really good walleye fishing, pike and muskie, panfish. So, I do a little bit of everything. I do some guiding. And, you know, I think just all doing all those different things, ice fishing even, is you learn how to use your electronics. You fish all types of water and different, you know, big baits for muskies. And, you know, all of that combined, I think maybe makes me a little bit more versatile, and that has served me well. You know, my first few years fishing, I got my ass whipped plenty of times, but I did well enough to kind of keep doing it, you know?
Sure.
And my consistency's a lot better now. I throw down a bomb every once in a while for sure. Kind of like everybody does, but, but when I see the smallmouth lakes on the schedule, you know, I'm excited because I certainly feel like I have some advantage there. But
sure,
the problem when you go to the Great Lakes or these places that are really good is the fishing so good that, you know, anybody that I'm competing against can land on one of these spots where it's, you know, catch one every cast, and it doesn't matter how good you are, you're not beating that guy.
Right. You know? No, that makes sense. What would you say your biggest strength when it comes to techniques go for locating smallmouth and fishing for them? Like what would be your, you know, let's say you have an event coming up on the Great Lakes or Lake Ontario or St. Lawrence River. Like,
yeah,
what makes you excited about that?
I think for me, if it's, you know, during the summer, I'm going to let the weather sort of decide, you know, before I even get too serious about fishing or get there or even like that day to, you know, dictate what I'm going to do. If it's going to be sunny, flat, nice, I'm going to fish shallow. And it doesn't matter if I'm on Ontario or the river or Champlain. I'm going to fish shallow and have, you know, a top water, a marabou jig, some finesse stuff. And I'm going to cover fish fast and look for biters. And I think anyone that comes up north to fish, if you're not familiar with it, those days when it's really nice, when it's sunny and hot, there's always going to be a lot of big fish up shallow. And it doesn't take long for them to show up. But the other side of that, if it's cloudy, windy, you could have the greatest day ever, and the next day if the wind blows and it's dark and you can't see, you're not going to catch them very good up shallow probably. And just knowing some of that kind of thing, you know, that sort of some of that stuff, I think is probably my biggest strength, just to be able to do what I got to do.
So understanding the conditions that you're faced with and then adjusting to that on all these different bodies of water is basically what you're saying.
And because you know, people always say, "Oh, smallmouths move so much," and it's not so much that they just if the weather's stable for any number of days, they're probably not going to move. But they move when the weather forces them or tells them to move. I think more than just randomness moving randomly, you know.
Sure.
And that's one thing that I guess if you fish for them enough, you maybe understand that a little bit better.
Mm-hmm. No, that makes sense. Now, would you say what would be your favorite way to catch a smallmouth? Basically, time of year and like what would be the ideal situation? I could say you're going to get to go smallmouth fishing today. Pick your pattern. What would that pattern be?
For sure. No question. It's casting a little marabou jig. I make my own. And I know you, I remember one time fishing in Little Sturgeon around you. And this was when it was like, no one really knew how good it was and no one was using it there. And it worked like so good at that place. And you could go around like in those packs of boats and catch like 8 fish to everybody's one. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me, it's just something that I have a lot of confidence in. I've caught thousands of bass on those things, and that's my kind of signature bait, I guess, if for lack of a better term.
Sure.
But like a small little hook, a number one, you know, Gamagatsu hook in the jigs that I make. But if you use that on the right rod, a long soft rod, some braid, it's probably the best hooking bait there is. You're fish, you know, you're catching fish in open water most of the time.
Sure.
And you just, you know, fight them, but it, when they bite it, I mean, they're just biting the hook. So it's, you know, usually you hook them up pretty good and it's a pretty safe bait.
Sure. Now I don't want to, I'm not going to let you off the hook on this one here. So we're going to talk a little bit more deep into hair jigs if we can here for a moment or two. So you tie your own. Do you sell them as well, or is it just something for your personal use?
I have a lot of buddies that ask me for them. You couldn't make money selling them the way I mean, it takes me 10 or 15 minutes to make one, and it's I don't really love doing it. There's a football game or a hockey game on, I'll sit around one evening and tie them up, and you just tie enough to get you through the summer kind of thing. I never have like I'll have 50, 70 made up maybe by the spring, hopefully, and then by the end of the year, I'm usually, by the time I use them, give a few away.
Sure,
I'm too nice, so like I'll have a couple of my southern buddies will show up at Lake St. Clair or the river, and oh man, I need a couple of those hair jigs. I finally tied one on, and then you know. Okay, so you dump two here, two there, and I don't sell them. A friend of mine, Brian Gustafson, same last name, we're actually not related, but he lives here where I do as well, and has a really good store called Lake of the Woods Sports Headquarters, and he gets some made that are the nicest ones I think you can buy with a Gamagatsu hook. They're tied really nice, good jig head, and all that stuff. So.
Sure. Now, but
the number one thing for with the jigs is the hook. You want a small hook, but you know, I'm gonna use one with a gammy in it, and then I like to put a little bit of a body on the shank, a piece of plastic, and that allows you to cast it a lot farther, and it keeps it sort of bulked up a little bit, so it doesn't just look like a drowned rat in the water. Sure. And so, my friend Brian, he sells the jigs with the cult with a little keeper on the shank, and then he actually sells the jigs if people want to tie their own with that little keeper on there as well.
Okay. Now I know that obviously you can make them in many different sizes. If you could kind of break down, are you normally sticking with just one or two different sizes, or do you have a wide variety?
No, I use a 3/32 most of the time. At home we have really nice cabbage weeds up here, and it you know, we call it tobacco cabbage, where it's like the big brown and red leaf stuff, and when it's hot out in the summer, these smallmouths will actually suspend and just sort of lay next to these little clusters that maybe there's 3 or 4 stalks. And I'll use a 1/16 a lot around home, and that really stays up pretty high in the water column. And then as heavy as I go would be like an eighth. And if I'm fishing on the Great Lakes and it's windy, or you want to get down in that, like, you know, 10 to 12, 14 foot range, then the eighth is better. But an eighth ounce to me, I mean, that sounds really light to everybody probably, but an eighth ounce to me sinks like a rock. And you know, the number one thing with a little hair jig is I don't want it to touch the bottom. I want it to glide through the water column, if that makes sense. And just kind of pendulum along. And that's that. And they just, I mean, if you put it in front of one, there's a good chance they're going to eat it. And so the fish have to be relatively shallow. I mean, it's not a bait that you're going to use in 20 feet of water. I've dropped them down in 20 feet of water. You know, if you're sitting on top of fish and you can't get them to bite, and I've caught a few, but that's not where it's like magic. It's magic when the fish are shallow.
Sure. So you're really ideally making long casts and you're basically swimming that through the water column. Are you varying the speed at all, or is it a pretty consistent, where are we talking, slow, medium, fast retrieve? What do you find?
Kind of slow and steady. And a lot of times, I mean, like a place like the river, those big ones, when they're shallow, I mean, they're really black and dark, and you can see them from a long ways away. And I've had lots of times where, you know, you're winding it along and you see one behind it, and sometimes you gotta like give it just a little pop or speed it up a hair, just change it up a little bit, and that'll trigger them to bite. But like if your jig's kind of going along and like one's coming behind it, they're gonna bite it behind it.
Sometimes that was one of the biggest learning experiences for me, especially when you could see a smallmouth chase a bait. So let's just say you're burning a spinner bait, you see that big smallmouth coming at it. You know, instantly when I first experienced that, your reaction is to stop that spinner bait or, you know, try to shake it or something. For me, it's real faster, and then that fish will come up. So I think you have to vary the retrieve based on the reaction of those fish. But when you were describing when you see a fish come up and varying that, we're not talking about all of a sudden you're reeling like super fast. It's just you're already crawling it. Now you're just even, it's still slow, right? But it's just moving a little bit faster than what you were.
Like that little bit of extra, I'm trying to really get away from this thing. And the other thing that I get asked a lot is, what do you think that a little hair jig, you know, is imitating?
Please what do you think?
The honest answer is, I think it's kind of like an after dinner mint. I mean, it's just something that's really small and subtle. And just, it's an easy grab, I think. It's not a steak, you know, like a spinnerbait or a jerkbait or a big topwater is like a steak. And they're not always in the mood for that. Sure. When they are, that's how you catch them. That's what you do. But when they're not, that little jig is just, I think it's just kind of an after dinner little mint. But I mean, I'm using black 90% of the time. I mean, that's no secret. Black will outfish every other color, in my opinion, everywhere I've ever been.
I agree with you 100%, but why do you think that is? Why wouldn't a brown or an olive or white work as well? I don't know.
Like,
that's crazy.
If I'm using a tube or a Ned rig, I mean, it's green pumpkin all the way. And you can get beautiful olive and green pumpkin-y colored marabou, and it just doesn't seem to work as well. And I mean, maybe part of that is just not giving it an honest, you know, but, and the same can be said for white. I mean, white is a bright, gaudy color, but it's also a natural kind of bright color. And, you know, a white fluke, or, you know, we have white topwater is what everybody's using. I mean, I've caught fish on a white marabou jig as well, but the black is for someone that's just going to go out and I'm going to learn how to do this. Just get a handful of black ones. That's what all you need.
Yeah, absolutely. As far as, you know, the effectiveness of a hair jig is being able to really get a nice long cast with that. So I assume you want to have your rod and reel dialed in. In your opinion, what's going to be the best reel size as well as the rod action and length that you found? And then I guess what type of line are we throwing those hair jigs on?
So So yeah, rod is the number one most important thing. And I'm using a 7.6. I use a G Lumis NRX. It's a really high end rod. But you want a 7.6, you know, a one or a two power, a light whippy rod. And that's what's going to allow you to launch that little jig. You can cast them a lot easier than you'd think. But yeah, 8 pound Power Pro. I put an 8 pound leader on, a 2500 or a 3000 size reel. I use a 3000 Shimano Xsense, and that's, you know, it's a high end setup, but it's like my favorite technique. So I'm, sure. You know, it's something where I want like the best stuff for it.
Sure. Now, obviously throwing these hair jigs with the wind is ideal to get that longer cast. Now, a setup like this, if you had a little bit of wind and you were forced to throw into it, would it still be worth it, or are you trying to position that boat so you can cast with the wind? I mean, is there times I know I get frustrated a lot throwing a hair jig into the wind, especially on bodies of water where wind's prevalent.
Right. With the wind is better, but if you're, you know, if you got to cheat it a little bit, I think going, you know, kind of crossways, and then, you know, you can actually have a little bit of a bow in your line with these jigs. And that's part of getting the feel for doing it right. I use Yellow Power Pro, and it's very easy to see. And I know like Chris and Corey Johnson, that they're good buddies of mine, and they like red, they use red line a lot. But same, you know, it's visible. That would be the best tip I could give anybody is, you know, if I'm flipping or frogging, I'm using, you know, like traditional, low vis green braid, sure. But for any of my spinning rods, we're putting leaders on anyway, so the fish are never going to see it. I want line I can see. And with these jigs, if you have a little bit of a bow in your line, like say you cast across the wind and you start dragging it, you really don't have to reel a whole lot if it's windy enough that it's pushing your boat along. You want to just pull that jig over the edge or over the boulder or over the whatever the sand spot that you're trying to hit. And if you have a little bit of a bow in your line, it's amazing. Like it'll jump and you'll know when you have a bite.
Sure. Sure. Now, where would you say the most effective, you know, if somebody wants to go out and try throwing the hair jig, is this a year round deal for you? And then what is the best like type of structure that you're going to throw this around?
So clear water, pretty important. I mean, you want it to be relatively clear. It's a sight thing. I mean, there's not a lot of vibration or noise or anything to it. But I think it really where it shines is you got to put it in front of the fish. You got to kind of have an idea of where they are. And that's why, you know, when it's bright and sunny, I think, and you can see good on the, you know, on the Great Lakes, that's where, you know, you know the fish are there, you can visually see them, and that's where it shines. And sometimes like a place like Sturgeon Bay, it's, if you see a fish there, they're very hard to catch in my, you know, experience. Mm-hmm. But then you go to like Champlain or the river, and it seems like you want to see them or, you know, and they're much easier to catch. My trolling motor's on a lot higher gear at those places. I'm looking to actually see the fish versus at Sturgeon Bay. It seems like you do better casting, but then at, you know, when I'm fishing these places like the river or Champlain, I'm fishing in the summer. So the fish are, you know, they're a little bit more independent. It's one here, one there, maybe two here, two there. When we're fishing Sturgeon Bay in May, you're around groups and you're looking for groups a lot more. And maybe that's part of why you get too close to that group and you just spook everybody and they don't like that. But
sure.
That makes sense or not, but
absolutely. Okay, so let's say you're up shallow, you're in that 10-foot range, you see that big smallmouth out there, he's facing away from you. Are you throwing that hair jig past that fish, swimming it towards it? Are you throwing it right at it? What's your technique to get that fish to tune in and zone in on that bait?
Yeah, absolutely. Cast past the fish. Sometimes you can land it right on top of them if they're not that smart and just let it fall to them and they'll bite it. But I like to cast past them. And just swim it swim it into his area, and usually it's just they just swim over and slurp it up. And
sure, is there ever a time when you've noticed or you've had success dragging that same hair jig on the bottom or hopping it, or is it just it doesn't really work that well? I'm curious on your opinion on that.
So at Lake Champlain, we fished at Champlain in 2020, and the first day of practice was windy, cold, and this was late July, and I actually committed my whole practice pretty much to fishing offshore, fishing deep. It's very similarly to how Palinuk won the tournament, like same area, same type of stuff. And the first day of the tournament, I run all these, like, you know, four or five good places that I found, and like I catch one fish, and like it was ghost town. Like they just moved, and I,
sure,
you know how it goes. Like I spent a couple hours, like, okay, they can't be that far. They're around here somewhere, trying to relocate them. Never did. And then by the afternoon, it kind of got slick and flat, and I literally ended up just going up shallow and fishing like stuff I'd never even fished before, and put together 17 pounds with a top water and survived the day. So day two, I go out, run some of this deep stuff again, don't catch anything. Like I have no idea.
Sure.
It still bugs me. Cause I know they're probably just like, I missed them some by 50 yards somewhere here. Or
with,
there,
with
you
know? Your 17 pounds the day before, where were you as far as,
right around the cut line, you know, okay, like in the around 40th, you okay know? So I stayed in the mix. So the next day I go, and by noon again, I'm like, I'm sucking. And I mean, Champlain is probably the easiest lake in the country to catch a limit on. I mean, it's sure, however you want to fish. For, you know, I say that, but here I am with one fish at noon, and right, and I'm like a smallmouth guy. So I get up shallow, and I fish through this area where I'd caught a few the day before, the spot that this point kind of bailed me out with the top water. And I get a hit or two. They're not biting it, and it just doesn't seem that, you know, it's not going very good. And I'm like at the point where, okay, this is bad. I got to put something together. And sure, I'm going along, and I see like three of them out in front of me, just cruising along, like 2.5 pounders, not big okay ones. I grab my hair jig, whip it out, and one just instantly swims over. I catch it. Okay. I catch another one. So, okay, I got to get my limit at least, and then I can worry about the next part of my problem.
Sure.
And I just start going along, like literally like trolling motor on 80. And when looking I'd see fun one, I'd slow down. I'd really slow down. And then I'd start seeing more, you know.
Sure.
You'd have a couple hundred yards of dead water, no fish. And then you'd get in a little stretch, and you'd be around some fish. And I ended up, mm-hmm, so I ended up catching, you know, a solid 18 or 19 pounds and made, you know, made the cut to fish day three. And then on day three, I mean, I didn't use anything but that hair jig pretty much all day, and just had an amazing day. I just cruised around looking for fish that I could see. But going back to your question of, do you ever use it on the bottom? Some of these fish, you know, if I got on top of them, kind of spooked them, they knew I was there. But they weren't like totally leaving the area. Like if they were just sort of doing the guard the rock game and
sure,
you know, hanging around kind of, I could catch those fish. And a couple of them, I remember getting my bait, you know, on the other side of them from the boat and getting them to look that way. And then I coupled them, I had it on the bottom and I was just sort of shaking it. And they just would swim over like almost sure like they were on a bed,
yeah,
and yeah, eat it. So that was pretty cool. But, so but there's a that's, often that's not a thing that I do, that, you know, I've had experience with often, but sure, but it worked there.
Sure. No, that makes sense. Awesome. So I guess moving on, that we covered a lot. That was some really good stuff, guys. I know a lot of the people that are listening to this are going to they're going to get excited. They're going to probably pick up a few hair jigs and give them a try, which I don't blame them.
Corey, if they saw this, they'd be pissed at me probably. That's the deal with it. It's just it. I know a lot of people, if you're not used to like using small baits and light line and light tackle, I mean, it's like a foreign thing, but I mean, it's, I've literally like, they've been popular, We have a lot of guides and a lot of resorts up here, and just a marabou jig is probably one of the first artificial lures there was, really.
Sure.
And there's guys, like when I was a little kid, guys in their 60s and 70s, that's all they use for bass. And it was just something from the time I was 16 years old, like in the late 90s, I would have, that was a go-to automatic, I had four fishing rods. There was always a hair jig tied on one of them,
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. What would you say, as far as a smallmouth angler, what would be some of your biggest weaknesses or areas that you'd love to improve on? Is there anything that you can think of when it comes to, I'm just giving you some examples, whether, you like to throw spinner baits for smallmouth and it's just something it works, but you don't do it that much. Is there anything that you wish you could improve upon?
Probably cranking a little bit. I mean, I'm not a big crankbait guy, but just like down south, I mean, I'm sure you've seen it. When that's the deal, you're not beating that with anything else, cranking.
Sure.
I had a tough tournament. I had two bad tournaments in 2020, and one of them was at Lake St. Clair. And, the smallmouth factory. And at that event, the live scope, the forward sonar deal was very important. And I didn't have it on my boat. And, I know I was around some fish and I'm in 18 feet of water and I'm trying to like get on top of them and see them on my
sure,
down imaging regular sonar. And, Corey Johnston comes up to me and pulls up like, "How you doing?" And I'm like, "No good." And, he's like, "I got like 20. And he goes, "Oh, there's two or three of them right here." And he flicks his drop shot out in front of his boat and catches a
sure,
4-pounder. And I'm like, "Oh,
yeah,
man, this is horrible." Yeah. And that was, I got to see it with my own eyes. So that I missed out on that a little bit this year. But I've used Hummingbird my whole career. And I mean, love their stuff. Their mapping's the best. Their sonar is awesome. Side imaging's awesome. And we're going to have that technology
yes,
here moving forward.
Yes.
I'm looking forward to that, but
it is.
But
at first it was nice, live scope and different things. And there was a select few guys that had it and utilized that. And now every brand's got their own version. So everyone's going to have it now, I guess.
Yeah. That's one thing. Like I mean, I could see, I'd be fine without being allowed to use that too. But
sure,
I guess it's here to stay probably, but
yeah, definitely.
But like people think an Alabama rig's going to ruin a lake. Well, like that's nothing compared to what's coming with these,
sure, it's exciting.
Machines.
Who knows? Can you imagine what it's going to be like 10, 15 years down the road, with electric?
Yeah, I know.
I don't even know. What's your personal best smallmouth? Let me know how it was caught and where and what was the situation and around that fish.
I caught it about it was a 760. I
wow,
caught it the day before one of those NABC tournaments at Sturgeon Bay.
Oh, really?
And
okay.
I caught it about, I don't know, you'd know the spot, but there's a little rock pile about 300 or 400 yards south of the boat ramp in Little Sturgeon.
Uh-huh.
And I actually caught it right off that rock pile.
Wow.
That would have been around 2010, probably. Well,
okay,
it's been a while ago now, but the interesting thing, good, cool story about this fish, but by far the biggest one I've ever caught, but a week, it was tagged. The fish actually had a tag,
oh, wow,
in it.
So sure,
tag number. And it had been tagged like up by Sturgeon Bay. So that fish had moved all the way down to Little Sturgeon. A week later, the following Friday, the day before the Sturgeon Bay Open, Chris and Corey Johnston, their dad was down there practicing with them. He
mm-hmm,
caught the same fish in front of the Cedars on the other side of Little Sturgeon.
Really?
A week later.
Wow.
Yeah.
Same fish.
So it's interesting. And I mean, you fish that place a lot, but there's nowhere else I've seen where like the conditions every day move those fish around, and it's just interesting. Like, they just circle around in those bays, I think, wherever
sure,
the wind's blowing, wherever the warmer water is. But that's just how that kind of went down, and kind of neat.
Yeah, that's a crazy story. I mean, that's your personal best, and then they catch it a week later, and you can actually see where it's been tagged. Any idea how old that fish was, or do they not? when you sent no, in those...
it was like 9 or 10 years old. I've got it. I've got an email from the biologist. I turned in the information I had, and he sent some stuff back to me. So I shouldn't, you know, it wasn't as old as, you know, a normal 5 pounder there would probably be. I think it was just a freak, and
sure,
you know, it wasn't a super old fish.
Wow. So if you could use one bait, I think we already know this question, but maybe not. If you could only use one bait next time you go out, or let's say for a whole year, you can only use one bait for a smallmouth, what would that bait be?
Z-Man hula stick. And really? You know, yeah. If I'm fishing shallow, that marabou jig is deadly. But it's not like a do everything, mm-hmm. you know, it doesn't work everywhere. One bait that will catch smallmouths everywhere, whether you're at Cherokee down in Tennessee, or you're at the St. Lawrence River, or you're at Rainy Lake, is a Z-Man hula stick. And it's a Ned Rig bait. It's a 4-inch worm. I usually cut a 1/2 inch off of it, maybe, and you know, put it on a little mushroom head, a little Ned Rig head, and that is a deadly fish catcher.
I agree with you 100% on that one. Now let's take it a step further. Now you got the hula stick, and you can only use one color. What's it going to be?
Green pumpkin.
Perfect.
Yeah. Sorry. Exciting, but
listen, sometimes when it comes to smallmouth, it's you keep things simple, and I mean it can't get much simpler than that, you know. So Gussie, what do you think separates yourself from some of the other top smallmouth anglers out there, you know, when it comes to smallmouth bass? What makes you so successful out there? Because your track record, it's proven, you know all the different bodies of water, the Great Lakes, the Northern Lakes, up by where you're from, the southern impoundments. When it comes to smallmouth, what do you think separates you from other anglers when it comes to smallmouth fish?
I don't want to sound like you know, like I'm the greatest smallmouth fisherman ever, because I'm not. But I, you know, I think just a lot of time into it and doing it a lot and just enjoying it and love for it. That's the thing that kind of works in my favor the most.
Sure.
You know, like Fider is another good buddy of mine. I'm sure if you haven't already, you'll talk to him for this.
Oh, he'll be on, sure.
He's like amazing with a crankbait for smallmouths. I mean, that's just, and a little swim bait. Like that's sort of the way he fishes for them a lot more, like more with horizontal baits, and where I'm, sure. you know, more of a tube or a Ned Rig jig person. But I think the best advice I can give, if you're at one of these places like the Great Lakes or Champlain, or, you know, I keep saying those places, just cause they're, you know, spots that a lot of people are going to fish.
Sure.
The biggest thing is if you're struggling and you're not catching any fish, you have to just keep moving. They're going to be, you know, unless there's like a really weird weather phenomenon happening or something going on. I mean, if you're not getting bites, you got to keep moving, cause they're going to be biting somewhere. And that's the biggest thing is, I like to just keep moving, looking for biters, looking for even, and if you're fishing deep, you know, there's a lot of times where you can get on top of fish, you know, they're there, you can see them on your screen, you can drop a camera down and see them. And if they don't want to bite, I'll literally drop my bait down to those fish once or twice, maybe try a couple of different baits. If they don't bite, you got to roll, pretend you didn't even see them, and come back maybe an hour or two later and try them again. Like you can keep doing that and that might work, but like if they don't want to bite, you're not going to force them to bite.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100% on that. It's frustrating. Sometimes you think they're just smallmouth, they should bite, but sometimes you run into those situations where you just got to bail on it. Keep moving, keep idling, looking, and all of a sudden you'll come across something special, hopefully. At least that's the plan. Out of all the Great Lakes, have you fished every Great Lake?
I have not fished Superior. Fished or Huron. I fished Michigan, Erie, St. Clair, Ontario, and then obviously the river. The river's probably my favorite.
I was going to ask. Place. That's your favorite area? Sure.
I just what I enjoy there is just the not having to get weathered out factor. Sure. I mean, you can kind of, you know, you're not going to die probably on the river if it gets nasty.
Right.
And I enjoy that you can fish however you want there. I mean, you go there in July, you go there in August, you can catch fish in 3 or 4 feet of water. And mm-hmm. if the conditions are, you know, right for it, and you can catch fish down in 35, 40 feet of water if you want to fish deep, and kind of everywhere in between. And that's kind of my thing that I enjoy the most about that place.
Awesome, Gussie. I appreciate you hanging out with us. Best of luck this coming season. And I know you guys are fishing some smallmouth bodies of water. What's one you're really looking forward to?
Well, we're actually ending the season at the St. Lawrence River and Champlain in early July, like a week or two earlier than we were at both places last year. So it's going to be Hair Jig Fest for me, I think.
Well, you better tie a bunch of them this winter then.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's as good as it gets. Two of the best places in the world. And, you know, so now thanks for having me. I'm looking, really looking forward to seeing all these interviews that you're doing with everybody. And I know you're going to, you know, catch up with some of my friends and some of the guys I look up to. And it's going to be this is a great idea. And I feel pretty fortunate that you thought of me for this.
Course.
And
absolutely.
You know, thanks.
Wow. What a great interview. I appreciate everybody hanging out with us today. Look forward to meeting up with everyone next week.
Thanks so much for listening today. Make sure that you're subscribed to the show and follow us on Instagram at smallmouthcrush. Also, the YouTube channel, smallmouthcrush. And if you feel so inclined, please leave us a 5-star rating and comment with a review below. And as always, until next time, we'll see you on the water.